Regenerative Farmers is a programme which supports farmer-led research. And what we do is put together farmers who have an interest in a particular subject, a researcher, to make sure the trials actually mean something. And what we can do is hopefully develop farming practices moving forward to become better than they already are.
We're trialling whether it's possible to produce cereals direct drilled into a permanent living cover that is there not just in between other crops, but throughout the whole process. In our case, living mulch is clover, but I guess it could be any low growing crop. Our challenge is to grow a cereal crop within that living mulch.
You've got the clover, probably no more than 6 inches tall, hopefully in the bottom, and then you can plant in one way or the other your cereal crop or your beans. They both happily survive together. You take your crop off at harvest and you're still left with that living mulch underneath, and it then can be grazed or whatever suits the farm.
There are a number of potential benefits to this living mulch idea. The reduction in ploughing is probably the key one, and the benefits that will come from that, whether that's carbon or soil health or weeds, annual weeds. Ploughing is expensive, power harrowing is expensive, and if we can reduce those cultivation costs and reduce our fuel use, that's positive financially as well as environmentally. In a mixed system like ours, we also get the grazing benefit. Grazing sheep in and around our rotation is the way we do it, to try and use the sheep as a fertility building operation in their own right. This is a time of year in August where normally our stubbles are yellow and lifeless largely. By having a green cover visible immediately on the day that we combine, once that straw is gone, the mulch is a grazable crop ready to go. At a time of year when to be able to bring lambs on here, for example, in the next couple of weeks, that's quite valuable.
When you combine the crop, if you can immediately bring the sheep onto there, then you've cut out 6 months worth of work and waiting for the clover and the grass lady to establish. So whilst we all assume there will be a yield penalty because of competition for nutrients and moisture, it's just trying to work out over the entire farm whether the yield penalty is worth putting up with when you consider how much more grazing you can have and ecologically how much better it is to have living roots in the soil all the time.
We need to look ahead with what's coming up with the challenges in agriculture, particularly with basic payment scheme subsidy actually decreasing by 2024, 50% of it will be gone anyway. Conventional farmers have a lot to gain, particularly reducing their inputs and cutting down not just on the sprays and the fertilisers, but also diesel costs and labour costs. You know, they're big costs.
Yes, you can have a margin around the outside with all your flowers and things in, but we haven't just got a field of oats. We've got a field of clover and oats. We've got flowers out there on the clover at this time of year. There's more bug life, so there's more birds. You know, it just does tick nearly all the boxes for that diversity out in the field and looking after the soil underneath.
What have we learned? We've learned we can do it. We've learned we can certainly establish clover undersown. We can direct drill into it. We know that will make perennial weeds worse, but we now know it will virtually eliminate annual weeds. We can get a crop to harvest, that's clear, but we need to close that yield gap and work out how to favour the cereal at the expense of the clover as it goes through. We can accommodate a 0.6 tonne to the hectare yield penalty without being any worse off financially, and that's basically savings in cultivation costs. There are a great number of non-costed benefits. It's impossible to put figures on those, the carbon sequestered, the improvements to soil health and soil structure. So we're going to have to think very carefully about what those non-costed benefits and disadvantages, the buildup of perennial weeds being the obvious one, equate to.
The important thing would be to choose the species of white clover to start with. You mustn't choose a plant that's going to be too competitive with your cash crop. The smaller leaf clovers hopefully will be strong enough to suppress weeds, but not too strong to be detrimental to the cash crop.
White clover's worked well. We went for the 70% micro wild white clover, which in theory is very short. I'm interested in trying pure micro and really going as low as we can. I think I would certainly recommend that. I would recommend not introducing anything tall, certainly no grasses, and anything that's going to get up in that crop. The system that would appear to me to be perhaps the way forward for us, to not be too ambitious in terms of keeping the mulch through into a second or third, fourth cereal. We may be able to have two-year periods within our 4 years of cropping that involve a living mulch. So it rewrites the rules in a way, and the whole system of nutrient budgeting changes when we have clover growing alongside our crops. This does create really quite an exciting possibility that we may not even need to follow the principle of a fertility building period, which of course organic arable farmers have to carry that financially throughout the rest of the rotation. But if we have clover in the ground, either mature or juvenile clover, every year for our cropping period, do we need then a fertility building clover lay at the end of that to replenish the nitrogen in the ground? Quite possibly not. It's certainly challenging the basic concept of fertility building followed by exhaustive cropping. Now we've combined the two things together. I guess it's like all good trials. We've answered one or two things, but in answering those, we've created a whole load of new questions. We're producing a human food crop on the top. We're producing a fabulous pollen and nectar mix and a great habitat in the middle. But also underground, we're building soil and fixing nitrogen and feeding soil life all at the same time. So all three things are simultaneously happening. Human food is only one of those things, but we sort of expect it to pay for the others. And maybe that's not fair. You know, maybe if we had a system, really dreaming now, but maybe if we had a system which paid for the other two as well, then as a gross output, maybe this field is actually producing a great deal more.
Farmers are clever. They know what might work, and what we want to do is bring that knowledge forward and let's find out whether it does or doesn't. Often what we're talking about is things that they maybe used to do historically or grandfather used to say, and it's just adapting practices which doesn't suit the agenda of other outside actors. And one of the big outcomes of these projects may not be the trial result. It may be that group of farmers who, having worked together, have learned from each other and taken the learnings and even the failures of the trial and turn it into something that's much more positive and forward thinking.
My main tip would be give it a go. Just do a small part of the ground. If it's going to go into a break phase in the rotation anyway, what have you got to lose?
Do a small plot. That's what we've started with. Keep coming back to us, doing it and further forward and have a go. It's all you can do, really.